Thank you, Professor Megnazi, for this interesting presentation of communal and personal memory. And I forgot to mention that Professor Megnazi is also the founder and director of a scientific journal dedicated to trauma and memory. In online journal. We know, where is Filippo Petrucci, yeah?
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. From the University of Cagliari, Filippo Petrucci holds a PhD in history of Africa from the University of Cagliari in Italy, with a thesis on the comparison between the Jewish communities in Algeria and Tunisia during 1942-43. After his PhD, he was awarded many, many international fellowships, which permitted him to continue his research in archives in Israel and elsewhere. And we will hear his lecture impatiently.
I put my time in.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you to all the organizers. Ani Rossi Lechodot Lechaverim Benzvi and Centro di Documentazione Ebraica Contemporanea l'Università Roma 3. Sorry for my English, I don't use this language for a long time, so sorry for my mistakes and my accent. Since the 70s, the use of oral testimonies has come to be appreciated as an important means by which to analyze historical facts and meanings. Whereas the use of oral history was originally only seen in study of folklore, it had become recognized as a crucial component in disciplines including the histories of labor, minorities, and gender. Oral testimonies proved fundamental to Lucette Valency and Nathan Wachel, analysis of Jewish community, Memoir Juive, especially because of a complex international situation where minority could not reveal their approach to daily life. Moreover, the global determination not to forget the events of World War II occasioned a specific research project that were aimed at collecting oral testimonies from Jews who survived the Holocaust in order to preserve memories and ensure wide remembrance. Oral testimonies are actually the object of several international projects within research center and international institute. Related Jewish studies are willing to preserve memories. For this reason, the importance of ongoing projects such as European Holocaust Research Infrastructure was financed under the Settimo Programma Quadro. Or the work made by United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, or the British Library, and the Spielberg Foundation, and other. In every work of historical analysis, the essential data come from first from archival sources at only a later moment from other materials. In my speech, I have decided to resort to oral sources and family testimonies. I try to offer some space to the account of some protagonists of the time. Using oral sources and books of family memories, I have tried to show the historical period of the World War II as the North African Jewish community lived it. I also use transcripts from interview of Northern African Jews founded in the archive of Yad Vashem or United States Holocaust Museum. The history of North African community during the Holocaust is different from Europe, talking in this part of the conference, I think I try to give an idea of Morocco, Tunisia, and I will focus more Morocco, Algeria, and will focus more on Tunisia. And in the final part, I will make some evaluation. Morocco had deep historical differences from Tunisia and Algeria. The French colonization in Morocco was briefer. European population there have been smaller, and a particular and strong relationships existed between the Moroccan Jewish community and the state authority of the Sultan. I found that some interview about Morocco, in this case, are not made by me, but by the United States Holocaust Museum. The first is Donna Audrey. She talked about her childhood in Tangier, Morocco, her family structure, how her family spoke modern Spanish, the relation between Jews, Catholic, and Muslim, about the different movement on the family, the work restriction during the war by Vichy law, the build of the children. So it's a family history, and but also she talked about the World War II. Madame Pinto is a bit not sure of the sequence of events during the war, but she definitely does remember the Vichy law forbid Jews from practicing medicine or law or other profession, because also his family was touched by this law. So if for this reason that she know this. She remember also that her younger brother was expelled from his friend's lycée and obliged to enroll in a vocational school. Madame Pinto remember also when the Allies arrived to liberate Morocco. The other is Guy Nouchi. He was born in Kenitra and 40 kilometers from Rabat. His parents were originally from Algeria, so he took the French nationality, and in the family they speak French. Also, he talked a lot about the situation, about the Vichy law, about the consequences on the family, and also he explained that he attended the secular French public school because he was French, and the director of the school allowed to Guy to stay on, although the Jews were supposed to be permitted to attend French public school, because he was probably a Gaullist sympathizer. So he remembers perfectly the 3 days of the arrival of the alley. And also he talked about the after war and the relationship with the Muslim and with the government. There are other several testimonies on the Morocco war, but I will try to take a little bit of all the three countries. About Algeria, Algeria was the oldest French colony in Africa, and it was considered part of the metropolitan French territory. And by virtue of the Décret Cremieux, Algerian Jews were made French citizens in 1870. So the situation for the Algerian Jews was different from the other. I have two testimonies that I collected years ago. The first is Monsieur Chouraki. Monsieur Chouraki met me in Aix-en-Provence in 2008. He grew up in Oranie, a city of Belabès, and in 1939 was in Casablanca working as a lawyer. In 1940 was mobilized as a French. After the armistice, there was Pétain, and he told me, I'm Jew d'abord, and French later. It was impossible for me to go battle with Vichy and the Germans, also because it was forbidden, but he didn't want. So he tried to join the Gaulle and Leclerc. It was Leclerc in Tripolitania, and he participated with the 2nd Division Blindé, and later they landed at Utah Beach, Normandia, and then in Paris, and then Strasbourg, and he finished the war because he arrived in Germany and Bavaria, and he just opened the champagne in the Eagle Nest, in the residence of Hitler, because they arrived in the Eagle Nest. He talked also about anti-Semitism. He told me, I felt anti-Semitism during all my life, in one form or in another form. And he told that also in university in Algeria, there were several anti-Semitic professors. So I asked him which kind of anti-Semitism existed, an a French or an Arab anti-Semitism. He told me, no, I never suffered from anti-Semitism on the part of the Arabs. The anti-Semitism that I have known in Algeria was a French anti-Semitism. In Algeria, there was segregation. There were the French were coming from the metropole. They called themselves true French. There were also many Spaniards who had become French, and that the true French, the first, called the other the neo-French. Then there were the Jews, and then there were the Arabs. There were four entities, and among these four entities were real barriers. They told me also about the Orania, because in Orania the elections were made solely on the basis of anti-Semitic political party. And he also sing a song. I tried to put this in my presentation, but it doesn't run. Also, the other interview doesn't run in this computer. But he sing the song that the people sing, about les Juifs, il faut les pendre. Finally, he stayed in France after, and when I asked to him why, despite all this anti-Semitism, did you stay in France? He told me, actually, very quickly, I considered that French was not Vichy, not the Russian law. For me, France was liberté, égalité, fraternité, was the right man, was the goal. It was not Vichy, so I want to stay in France for this reason. The second interview was made in Netanya in 2010 with Madame Zawi. She was born in Algeria in 24. She also was from Orani, from Tiaret. It's an accurate account of the war, the Russian laws, and a limitation imposed on Jews. Also, I ask her what life was like during the war and what kind of anti-Semitism existed. Life was hard. There was Petain Legion. It was Vichy. But I can tell you that we were comfortable with the Arabs. Anti-Semitism was primarily from Europe by European settlers. Of course, there were also Arabs who didn't love us, but especially the French settlers had a racist attitude toward the Jews. In both of these two testimonies, he stressed European anti-Semitism. I believe that also this aspect is important. Tunisia was a protectorate which maintained a kind of autonomy, even having a local chief like the Bey. Also, Tunisia had a long-lasting colonization, strong effort from French ascendancy, and a widespread and diverse European presence. We know because we talk about this, in Tunisia there exist different Jewish community, the Grana, the Italian Jew, the French Jew, the big community of Tunisian Jew. And we also see that in Tunisia we have different moments of the war, the arrival of the Nazi fascist and the occupation of 6 months, and other things. For Tunisia, I have some oral testimonies, but after I want also give some example of family histories. The most complete interview was with Mathilde Arbib, born in Sfax in January 21. I met her in Paris in July 4. And she told me that in Sfax, under the French occupation, we lived well, and even with the Arabs, we lived well. She talked a lot about this. She tells of his marriage during the war, the Germans, the requisition, and the relationship with the Arabs. Also, she talked about after the war. We don't talk about this in this case, but I think also this is interesting because she told me that his husband was... had a good relationship with the Arabs, and at the moment of independence, some Arabs asked to him to change religion because he was really good a man, so they want that he become chief of Camera di Commercio, Chambre de Travail, and they asked to him just to become Muslim, to be sure with him. I meet also Paul Sebak and his wife, Diana Gallico. They were very nice, but it was a short interview because the professor was already very ill. In August 2004, with the daughter of Madame Arbib, then translating from Arabic, I went to Djerba, and we visited several synagogues and the kindergarten and some houses. We can see in the photo in the left the kindergarten and in basso, Bere Saban in front of one synagogue, and Messauda Saban, she's making wine with inside the house. I talked with him, they had a little fear to be filmed with the camera, but then there have not been problems. And we talk about the goal of Djerba stolen by Nazi. Bere Saban showed me the synagogue where the goal was collected, and then he told me that it seems that the goal never arrived in Germany. In Maret, it seemed the Arab brigands intercepted the cargo and the stolen gold. So this is just history. But I think it's interesting to see also the life today of this community. Another interesting meeting. Now, this is still Djerba. There's several parts of Djerba, of different synagogue. And another interesting meeting was David Guetta. We arrived at the great synagogue of Avenue de la Liberté in Tunis in August 2004. I met Monsieur Guetta several times. And we talk about the past, and we talk about the war. And he told me that he was sent to Bizerta camps, and he tells of some episode of the war, and also he said that the relationship with the Arabs was good. When we talk about the hand of the history of the Jew in Tunisia, because there are less than 2,000 Jews in Tunisia, he told me, when Tunisia was still constituted by tribes, the Jews were already there. They lived in the mountains with the Berbers. Then we managed to live with the Arabs. We live well with Tunisian. We, in my opinion, are the better Arabs. We also endured the Nazi hell. We are now less and less. Young people are nearly all gone, and all died. Is the shame? Is the history? That's all. So it was quite cynic. Also different, and I know I have 4 minutes. Okay. Yeah. There are also different history from family that I have the change to read, because they printed and they just written this book for family and friends. One is the Histoire de la Famille Lombroso, written by Bruno Lombroso, printed in November 2006. It's a historical work in the word of the author. It's an expression of respect from the long lineage of our forefathers, who must never be forgotten. This is a meticulous text that tracks back the history of the Lombroso family. And it talks also about the memory of World War II and the relationship before with the fascists, after with the Germans, and also with the other. With the other Jew, because it tells the it's interesting to note that both the cabinet of the father of Lombroso and the house in the city were seized from him under the accusation of being a dangerous fascist. So we talked before they arrived, and went to Monsieur Haddad, president of the Jewish community of Tunisia. This is a moment I don't talk about this, but it's about the difficult relationship between the Italian Jew and the French and the Tunisian Jew in Tunisia. The other book, Enfance, is a work completely different. It's just a remembrance of her childhood in Tunisia. And she also talked about World War II. What is interesting is maybe the life of during the World War II, see with the eyes of a 5-year-old girl. Then there is a book Mabruk. This is, was published. It's made by Nadia Galli-Cospano, and it's an autobiography of Nadia Galli-Cospano. It's quite famous. It was also a member of the Assemblea Costituente. Was in one of the first women elected in the parliament. And the other little book is Qualcosa su mia madre, written by Lucia Valenzi. Lucia Valenzi, she's the daughter of Maurizio Valenzi. He was a partisan in Tunisia, and after he was major in Napoli. And the mother of Lucia Valenzi was Liza Cittanova. So this book is on her mother. Also, this book, I think, can give an idea about the Tunisia during this year. After, there are other books, something like Les Nuages de Beautemps, de Claude Azrea. Other book published by Frédéric Gasquet, Les Lettres de Mon Père, about the Chemla family. And but this book, they are published, so they have. We can find this. I finished. Okay. One moment. We can say that the oral history can be played a role, and maybe an important role, in the writing of the history of the Jew of North Africa. However, we must understand how to use this data and what direction to take in the narrative. It will be important to understand how opinions may have changed over time, how it changed the attitude and the relationship with the Arab community. Professor Menaggi talked about clima and perception. I think this is the work to do the. Because all the sources, also the archive sources, can be used in different manners. So it depends how we use this. And finally, I think that the study of the oral testimonies, it's important also to explain to the new generation of European coming from Arab Muslim country, because often they ignore the multi-faith history of the countries from which their grandfather comes. So maybe also this kind of history can help to fighting the new wave of anti-Semitism. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Filippo Petruti for his interesting presentation, and we know